part of the political process. And they did a great job. Some of you may be aware of it, most students may not. It was a long effort. They went to the Naxalites, they went to the government, they told the Naxalites, these talks need not be prejudicial to your political position, either the state or the Naxalites. The Naxalites can continue to hold the belief, the conviction that the armed struggle is the only way out, and they can continue to have that strategy. Fine. The state can continue to hold its understanding that there is no scope for an armed struggle within the ambit of the Indian constitution. You keep your political, ideological positions intact. Given that, there is tremendous scope for some kind of dialogue, some kind of political process. Because I think the Committee of Concerned Citizens was motivated by the fact that the people had to benefit in material terms, in terms of freedom, dignity, etc. Whoever the actors. I think the welfare of the people as a touchstone of political legitimacy was what guided the entire effort of the Committee of Concerned Citizens. It is a very interesting, remarkable effort, I would imagine. In retrospect, it seems even more precious now, very much needed. They went around talking to Chandrababu Naidu. It was a long effort. I told you, over a period of time, it happened. It started in the TDP regime. They spoke with Chandrababu Naidu. They spoke with the TDP. They were reluctant, because there was a point of view that talks were possible, a dialogue was possible with the Naxalites only if they professed a belief in the Indian constitution, only if they laid down arms. They were not able to convince the TDP government at that point of time, but they continued nevertheless to tell both parties. For instance, they told the state repeatedly that going in for a dialogue does not mean that you are conceding the legitimacy of the armed revolution anymore. I remember they addressed the Maoists in this instance, that you coming to the dialogue table does not mean that you are conceding the legitimacy of the electoral process. But you need to sit down, because enough violence has happened. Enough misery is on place, on board. And there has to be this political initiative at some point of time. It didn't happen during the TDP time. And Rajshekhar Reddy came to power, we all know what happened. For 6 months there was a ceasefire, there was talks, there was dialogue, but they essentially broke down because the government went back on. They broke down because the government decided that it needed to go with what the police felt, that any kind of ceasefire, any kind of dialogue has to be ultimately, as Balagopal frequently point out, predicated upon the ultimate surrender of weapons by whatever political movement you're talking about. So they broke down in February 2005. But this is required in Chhattisgarh. This is required in the context of Greena. One can't emphasize this more. I remember when we went there, we could easily see in 2006-2004 what was happening. This is before Greena. And we realized that there was nothing happening in terms of a vibrant civil society within Chhattisgarh. You've all heard of the case of Vinayak Sen, the PUCL. He was jailed, the PUCL, virtually unable to function within Chhattisgarh. Today in Chhattisgarh, you cannot have a proper fact-finding, which we are all very accustomed to. Couple of days from now, I go back to Vishakhapatnam for an encounter killing fact-finding, where two people were killed in Vishakha agency. This is not possible in Chhattisgarh. You've heard the news yesterday, day before, where 20 people were killed. Some say they're less than that, Maoists were killed. It's not possible for a rights organization to actually go and do fact-finding. That is the situation there now. Very disturbing. We met university teachers, professors, journalists principally, asking them to bring pressure on the government to have your reporters on the ground. You please notice that most of the news from Chhattisgarh in the Telugu press comes, it's either Dateline, Chintur, Bhadrachalam. How do you kind of report from 200-300 kilometers away? You need to be on the ground. You need to be an eyewitness, and you talk to eyewitnesses. It's the basic rule of journalism. It's absent in Chhattisgarh, in Dantewada, in Bijapur. And the current context of the Green Army. Chidambaram, it's amazing how they boil it, how they abuse, how they distort, pervert all notions of what we value, notions of democracy, notions of justice, notions of fair play, decency. You talk to Chidambaram, you remember what he said during the initial days of the Green Army, when there was this massive amount of
police, armed forces, all kinds being pumped into the Dandakaranya area. When somebody asked him, what is this for? He says, he's a very soft person, he's educated, Harvard, etc. He has a long bio, very smooth guy. He says, it's to re-establish the rule of law in Chhattisgarh. Nothing can be a more laughable proposition than this. What is the track record on the rule of law? What is the establishment's track record in Adivasi areas with regard to the rule of law over the past 6 decades or so? You take any piece of legislation meant for ameliorating the condition of the Adivasis, any piece of legislation that has come about, one of 70, you take PISA, self-rule legislation, Panchayat extension scheduled areas in 1996, and the more recent Forest Rights Act regulation. Has any of them been honored over these years? And these didn't come about from the sky. These didn't come about on the statute book because Madam Sonia Gandhi thought they were a good thing for the tribals. Each of them has a history of struggle, blood, sweat, toil, and tears, and great sacrifice on the part of the Adivasis, and people who stood with them, and fought with them. And every bit of legislative protection that they had has been abused, distorted, used against them. We all know that. As human rights activists, we confront it every day. How one of 70 is rendered meaningless. The tribal land legislation, alienation is illegal under the law, but it's rendered just a piece of paper. How the PISA, the Panchayat Extension Scheduled Areas Act, says that the Gram Sabha has all the authority and you have to consult the Gram Sabha. You need the consent of the Gram Sabha. Do they honor it? No. Never is it honored. Have you heard of any single developmental, so-called developmental project in the fifth schedule area, or for that matter in the northeast, in the sixth schedule areas, where the Adivasi Gram Sabha has been consulted, where the village council has been consulted, their consent taken? It's meaningless. You abuse the law in this manner. And then you say, we are going to re-establish the rule of law. What is this? How they distort precious values, civilizational values that have come to us, which we need to protect for a better way of life, particularly for the wretched of the earth. And they've been doing it consistently. Chidambaram, I mean, he's a very funny person. He says, he continues to maintain that he's all for talks. The Maoists come forth and say, lay down some countries, there's nothing happening from the other side. They're simply not interested. They seem to hold the opinion post-LTT in Sri Lanka that this movement can be wiped out militarily. You know, when we address the state vis-a-vis this Maoist movement over a period of time, we would always say, don't look at the violence. Don't build an entire discourse around eruption of violence, incidents of violence. Look at the underlying causes. What has given rise to this movement? What is the material deprivation that has given rise to this movement? What is the social oppression that has given rise to this movement? What is the unfreedom that has resulted in an average, ordinary citizen picking up the gun? Look at that, address that. That would be a meaningful democratic way of dealing with this whole phenomena, not pumping in more and more and more and more of armed forces, specialized forces. It's very interesting. Balagopal made this very significant point. Some of you can hear it actually. There's a cassette outside. It's a very interesting cassette which contains some of his speeches. Please listen to this, called Human Rights in the Time of Terrorism. This was a speech he delivered in Bangalore, post Sri Lanka, post the decimation of the LTT. And he makes the point. And he makes the point that when we address the state to look at the underlying phenomena, to look at the underlying causes, it does not do it. It does not do it because it politically, ideologically, does not want to concede the fact that this movement has a social base, that it has a social base among the people. It will not concede that. It will not look into that. But in its military strategy, it certainly does that. In the state's military strategy,